Thank you for listening to the Because and Effect podcast. My name is Nolan Bicknell, and I'm now joined in studio at the CJNU 93.7 radio studio in downtown Winnipeg by Malaika Siemens. She is a student studying education at the University of Winnipeg and just an all-around excellent person. Malaika, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
So I was given your name by a colleague that interviewed you for our Vital Signs project, which happened in 2022, talking all about education and talking about the Build From Within program. So maybe before we talk about Build From Within, actually, I've been asking everyone at the start of the podcast, what's your story? So if you could answer that, how do you answer when someone asks, what's your story?
Well, my story begins in Winnipeg. I was born here, and I lived across from the University of Winnipeg for 13 years downtown. And it's always been me and my mom. My mom was a single teen mom and raised me, and she's a really powerful woman. I went to Sister Mac School for elementary, and that's where I started learning more about being Indigenous and what that means. And sort of the friendships that I made there really shaped my view of education as a whole, because a lot of children in that area are low income, or they're coming from different countries to Canada for a better life. And I think we were all bonded in a way culturally, because we understood that even if we were from different parts of the world, we were still very connected through being in Winnipeg and growing up downtown and some of the things that we've seen and experienced. I went to Grant Park for high school. And it was not until, I think, grade 11 until I actually met my Indigenous grad coach, who would later become the leader of Build From Within. And I went through a lot of different phases in my identity, because I am mixed, and I was kind of navigating what that means for me and how I identify in a predominantly white school. So that also really had an impact on me, and I've been in Build for 3 years now.
Very cool. So yeah, Build From Within, a very cool program trying to get Indigenous students to become Indigenous teachers. Can you just give me a breakdown of what that program is and how you got involved and why?
Yeah, so usually you start in high school. So I was in grade 11, I was 16. I met my grad coach and she said, "Have you ever thought of being a teacher?" And I said, "No."
And what did you want to be at the time?
I didn't really know. Like, I consider teaching, but the response that I usually got from teachers and family was, that's not good money. So it was either like doctor or lawyer, but I couldn't see myself in either of those careers. I really wanted to be a writer, journalist, or like an author. That was my thing. And it took about three times for her asking me to actually accept it. And I said, okay, I'll try it. So I wrote an essay, I got references, and sort of built my own like profile of myself, and then went through an interview process twice, two interviews. Then I got the okay, you're in. And
now
then
the
it was
begins.
Like, oh my gosh. And when you're in the high school phase, you finish your courses. And then you also start your EADP.
Which stands for?
Educational Assistant Diploma.
Gotcha.
Yeah. So I did that. And then COVID happened. So some of it was online. And then from the first year of university, you also start going into schools for your practicum.
Right.
And you start working with students.
Cool.
Yeah.
What's that been like? What are the kids like these days?
Oh my gosh. I love them. They keep me on my feet, on my toes. And I think there's a lot of different needs that we see in the city. Some of that has been displayed in varying degrees. So I think this year I'm seeing a lot of needs for emotional support, mental health support.
Right. Yeah, the ask on the teacher in 2024 now is substantial. You know, there's a lot of kids that don't have that structure, that emotional support at home or with friends, and then so you become the de facto person that they're looking to. And I've said on the show a lot of times that you only need, as long as a kid has one person to look to kind of guide and to have in their corner, that's all you really need, is just that one person that's going to bat for you. What's it like being that person to some kids now, when you were probably not too long ago one of those kids that was, you know, looking to teachers as these mentors, as these guides?
Well, I try my best. I don't know the impact that I've made, honestly, yet. I hope that I changed something for a student. I know that last year, in my second year, I was with grade 6 and 7 students. And I worked with one really closely on math. And I think, like, towards the end of the year, he said, like, "You helped me learn math." And I was like, oh.
Forever now. Like, that's a forever change.
And I always try to get notes from my students, like, if they have any feedback for me.
Like, how to improve?
Yeah. So I'll tell them, like, be brutally honest. Like, I'm learning.
What's the most brutally honest review
you've speak
gotten?
Up.
Oh, okay.
Because yeah, I'm usually pretty quiet. So I got to learn to use my teacher voice. And, yeah. But I taught them poetry.
Cool.
And they really liked it.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
It's such an opportunity to, like, really mold and change and, you know, help minds evolve. So I haven't been in school in 10 years. There have been wild advances in technology and iPads in the classroom, and the chalkboards are now digital and everything. That was 10 years ago already. But, like, what do you see? How do you see technology playing a role in education moving forward, and how do you use it now? And how was it used, and how are you using it to learn? Because I think there's just so much out there right now, and it's hard for me as an old man, or getting to be an old man, like, how to grasp all the chaos of technology when it comes to education. How are you implementing it, and how has it been implemented in the last few years?
So right now, I'm working with grades 3 and 4.
Okay.
So around 9 years old, 10 years old, and we use Chromebooks.
Wow.
So they use Chromebooks for math. If they're not using, like, they have mini whiteboards that they write on personally.
Okay.
And then, of course, you have, like, bigger whiteboards. But a lot of it is Chromebooks.
Wow.
And then they know how to navigate them, sometimes better than pen and paper. And sometimes there's iPads if a student needs some more support with, like, communication. Or if they have, you know, disabilities that require them to use technology, then that's also offered in schools. There's also, like, we use Minecraft. We use Minecraft.
Yes.
Education.
Yeah.
Which so, is...
Because isn't there a full scale of Winnipeg that you can walk around in and do? Or is that the program?
Yeah.
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 Wild.
We have... One of my coworkers, he's building an entire, like, world in Minecraft. I don't really know how it works, but he's doing it. And they're learning, like, about their city and their country and their world. And it's really cool.
Yeah, really
I like
interactive.
It.
I'm a big video gamer, so I saw that program, and I was just blown away that I wish we had that when I was a kid. You know, it's so cool. Do you think the sort of trending – I'm curious – obviously, I'm hoping 9 and 10-year-olds aren't on Twitter or Facebook or Instagram or TikTok yet, but what are your thoughts on how that whole ecosystem collides with education, and how people are sort of getting their information nowadays, and misinformation is out there, and fake news, and all these crazy worlds? But as a future teacher and current teacher, like, what are your thoughts on how do we navigate that as a society and as youth? Like, what can we do to mitigate the harms and also maybe use it for a more beneficial and, you know, happier society, if that's possible? What are your thoughts? Are you on social media?
I am.
Yeah.
I've been on social media since I was 9.
Okay, so there you go. It's happening.
I have a pretty big opinion on this. Mm-hmm. I don't think that students, at least grade 3 and 4, should not be on social media.
Like you were?
Yeah.
When you were 9?
Because I had the impacts,
right.
You know? It made me very self-conscious. Mm. It was too much information all at once. Adult information that I did not need.
Or understand the context of.
Yeah, don't even know how to, like, apply that to my 10-year-old brain.
Right.
And it also took away a lot of my curiosity of the world.
Interesting.
And I think even, like, when I was on Facebook and, like, when YouTube first started out, it wasn't nearly as intense as it is now. And my students do have Facebook, and they have Twitter or X. Mm-hmm. They have TikTok. They have Instagram, Snapchat. They have unrestricted access to YouTube.
Wow.
And it's scary because the things that I hear from them, I'm like, you should not know that. You don't need to know that. And you don't need to worry about
The anxiety.
Some of the stuff that's going on.
So are you having to take phones away in class? Is it like that much of a situation?
With them, it's not as common, but I do know that they have phones. And I have asked a few students before to put it away.
Mm-hmm.
And again, when they use the Chromebooks, they are sneaky and they know how to open tabs and hide tabs. And I've caught students, you know, on Instagram or looking up things that they shouldn't be looking at. Wow. So it's a challenge because I think we're seeing kids younger and younger question, why do I need to be in school?
Mm-hmm.
Why do I need this? I can Google it. I can look it up. I already heard about this on Facebook, or they don't even use Facebook, but
I Instagram. Saw it on a TikTok reel or something like that. My teachers used to say all the time, well, you're not going to have a calculator in your pocket, so you have to learn to do these things in your mind. And now now we're walking around with all of human knowledge in our pocket, and you can just say, hey, Siri, what was the, you know, what year did the Battle of Saratoga happen? And you get an instant response. So as a teacher, what is the approach to education when you can self-teach, you can self-learn, you look up a YouTube tutorial about anything? Like, how do you approach this in a more, like, looking in someone's eyes fashion rather than the more disconnected learning through a secondary source? Like, what's your approach?
I think a lot of it is telling them that they're going to need certain skills no matter what.
The soft skills, as they were.
Yeah. Like, and sometimes it's as simple as, like, you can go on your phone when you're at home, but when you're here at school, like, you are here to learn. And I think the strong urge to be on a computer or a phone for them comes from them maybe not knowing that they can do this on their own.
Mm.
And it's kind of like a reflex or just a habit.
Right.
So teachers are having to break these habits really young and really early. And honestly, it's like they fiend for it. Like,
it's an addiction.
It is. So I think it's also having some empathy and some grace, because this is what's normal for them. And they're too young to also understand how it will impact them in the future. Mm-hmm. I know from firsthand experience, I'm like, trust me, you do not want to be scrolling your life away at 9 or 10 years old. And it's just explaining that. And then it's making, like, learning as fun as possible.
Right.
Games. And if you do use technology, then you use it responsibly.
Yeah, you have to set the tone, set the standard.
You have to model it to them, you know.
So, I mean, talking about models, you said it wasn't until grade 10 or 11 that you had an Indigenous teacher, or is that, did I mishear you?
That was when I first met my Indigenous grad coach.
Okay, cool.
I didn't know that we had an Indigenous grad coach.
Right.
And I had my first and only self-identifying Indigenous teacher in grade 3.
Okay. Yeah, so representation. Talk a little bit about why that's important and how it can change someone if they see someone that looks like them, sounds like them, you know, reminds them of grandma or mom or whoever, like, especially in the education field right now, where it's just a bit of a gong show when it comes to getting teachers and retaining teachers and hiring and maintaining the system. But yeah, why is representation important? And why was it important in your case specifically?
For me, it changed how I thought of Indigenous people. I really felt like I knew her before I knew her.
An instant connection.
And when she would talk about her culture and her clan, I was so fascinated that, like, this was somebody that was successful and, like, doing the things that, well, I didn't know I would end up doing it as well, but, you know, it showed possibilities and doors that could open for me. And just seeing Indigenous people in different contexts and different careers is really important. I want students to see an Indigenous principal and Indigenous teachers in pre-cal and science, not just confined to one area of knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the biggest thing. You know, like, we have Indigenous grad coaches, which is amazing, and we need that. But we also need Indigenous people, like, being professors
every step of the way
and across the board, just in all positions. Yep. Yeah,
I've been thinking a lot about tokenization too, of just, you know, the one Indigenous kid in the class, or, you know, whatever the situation might be. When I say the word tokenization or the token, what does that bring into your mind? And how? Yeah,
it's like a weight. I feel it. It's labor. It's emotional labor. It's mental gymnastics, trying to explain something to a person who believes that what they're doing is not wrong and is not in any way offensive or uneducated. It's a mental load that a lot of Indigenous people, especially women, carry. I say especially women because society has kind of conditioned us to be very friendly and nice and responsive and, like,
polite.
Yeah. Answer questions if you're asked them.
Yeah.
The first, like, thing that I think about is when it was Orange Shirt Day, and the conversation, at least in high school, was always very short and felt very scripted. And then everybody kind of turns to you, like, well, what do you got to say? And you're honestly expected to really, like, share some personal stuff.
Or represent your entire race, you know? And,
yeah.
Like, who?
And it's so hard explaining, like, there's different tribes, there's different experiences, and not every Indigenous person has been connected to their culture or has the same beliefs. Like, it's just so, it's varied and, yeah.
The nuance of it all, that kind of doesn't really, it's not easy to translate nuance when you're being bombarded with questions from a dozen people at once. Yeah. What was the ratio of kid, like, were you literally the only Indigenous kid in your class, or, like, what was that kind of vibe?
In high school, yeah.
Yeah.
Most of the time. I took an Indigenous studies course, and there was two or three of us.
Wow.
And that was the most that I'd ever seen.
Was the teacher?
No.
No? Okay, interesting. No,
but he was amazing.
Okay, cool.
And he really did that course justice. And I just remember, like, looking around and thinking, wow, this feels so strange, you know. But I was happy to see. my fellow Indigenous students. And at the time at Grand Park, it took me probably until grade 10 to actually self-identify because of the amount of bullying and the prejudice that existed in that school. And it kind of scared me, you know, even with my closest friends, I didn't want to tell them that I was Indigenous because they would make jokes all the time.
Not knowing.
Not knowing. And it wasn't until a new person joined our friend group and he was Native, and he kind of looked at me and he was like, "Are you Native?" And I said, "Yeah." And everyone would kind of, it was like, "What? Thought you were white." But I usually just said I'm mixed, and that was that.
Yeah.
But grade 10, I started really repping like who I was, and I got comfortable with saying it out loud and and speaking up in class when I knew that something wasn't quite correct, especially in classes like history when, you know, Indigenous people are treated like one very short chapter in history, and it was often skipped over.
Or summarized briefly, a footnote here, and it's like, there's actually more to that.
Yeah. Yeah, and like our culture was always referred to as legends or myths, and that was something that really bothered me.
Verbiage is important. The words we choose are important. And I think that's a good example of like, that's a very specific, there's a reason it's mythical and like, oh, there's a reason for that. How do you think education has evolved or devolved in the last few years? Do you think it's trending in the right direction when it comes to Indigenous representation and like history specifically? Or is there still a long way to go? Like, I'm so far removed from it that I'm curious, like, I know that there are strides being made and attempts being made to try to bridge those gaps a little bit, but like, I also know that there's a lot of work to be done and there's still a lot of re-education that needs to happen. So like, what's your perspective in the last maybe 5 years or so?
My goal, and I think Built From Within's goal as well, is for consistency. Because it feels like there is this rush to sort of, okay, we need so much Indigenous education like right away, without much planning, without intention. And I just, I would like to see some consistent sort of plans and implementation of Indigenous knowledge. Because yes, we have, land acknowledgements now, but that has also evolved into a routine and a box to check.
Yeah, the joke is like, bathrooms are over here, land acknowledgements over here, all right, let's get to the event now. And it's like, that's not what it's supposed to be.
And it's become a, we're on your land, and what about it?
Right.
And honestly, it feels like a slap in the face sometimes, especially if it's being done, you know, when an elder is present. And I think it's amazing how far we've come compared to, you know, my mother's education and my grandma's experience. But I think we do have to keep going. We got to keep the momentum. And we can't just say, okay, we did our Indigenous thing of the day and go back to our regular program. But really like valuing the long-term kind of plans here. And that's also the goal of Built From Within, like having Indigenous teachers across the division. And we also do ceremonies together too. So we strengthen our understanding, but also our balance. Because you have to go into work balanced. If you aren't, your kids will pick up on that. Your students will know. They'll feel it. And the same goes for the system as a whole. We can feel the unease in the school system right now. And it's not just a Winnipeg thing. It's not just a Canadian thing. Like, it's everywhere. And I think a lot of the morals and the values of Indigenous education would address that.
Mm.
Because it targets what's going on inside.
Right.
Inside the spirits and the minds of students, and that's where they need to heal. If they actually want to be able to learn and open up their mind to, you know, abstract thinking and critical thinking.
Yeah, they need to lower the guardrails or the, like, everyone's got their walls up right now. And yeah, the unease. So how do we ease the unease? Like, what's the game plan for that? Like, obviously, Indigenous ways of knowing, that's kind of the core, you know, start from within. But specifically within your work, like, what are you hoping? Like, when there's, you don't have to get specific, but, like, if you can sense unease in a student, what's your approach? Or what can the approach be?
In our classroom, we have a part of the room that's really cozy and it's quiet, and that's for self-regulation.
Mm.
And there's also instructions on the wall how to do that, how to breathe deeply and kind of letting those bad or like negative thoughts kind of float by. And there's also movement breaks, and there's a room where they can go and they can work out. And it's actually pretty fun in there.
That's sweet.
Like, they can run. They have, like, different toys to play with. And it's getting down on their level. Mm. Being eye to eye and looking at them. And you try to breathe deeply and you show them what that looks like. And you just reassure them that whatever they're going through, it will pass, and that they have supports in place, and following through with that. If their family needs a hamper, if they need clothes, it's really cold, if they need like toques, mitts, scarves, if they need food, then you provide that. And that's the most basic elements of being alive and being human. But for some reason, it is not always available in schools.
Not prioritized in our culture, yeah. Society, really, hey?
Yeah. Like, if I could put a breakfast program in every school, I would. High school, elementary, I don't care how old you are.
You need fuel,
you need breakfast.
Yeah. We were just saying before we recorded, neither of us had breakfast today, though, so I don't know, maybe we should take our own advice, but no, kids especially, they're just little machines that need that fuel to keep going, for sure.
Yeah.
You mentioned a couple minutes ago the word ceremony, and I've been thinking a lot post-pandemic about just rituals and ceremonies and the importance of that as a human, and I didn't really understand it. Our family had a couple of losses recently, and weren't able to have funerals or weren't able to sort of get that closure. And I didn't really realize the vital importance of ritual and of ceremony in my life until recently. And I'm just curious what your perspective is on the intersection of ritual and ceremony within education, just to help regulate and help guide and help connect people. And I just wonder your thoughts on that.
Yeah, so a few schools, like I go to Nijimakwa twice a week to study and do homework. That's like our home base right now for Build From Within students. Smudging is regular. It's not a foreign practice anymore. And different schools across the Winnipeg School Division will smudge, and also sharing circles that may not be thought of as a ceremony, but it is. And it's accessible for students. In my first year of practicum, I did circles every week with the students.
It's powerful.
It is. And I think that it's... My students had a winter concert recently, and they performed the bear song.
Okay.
And seeing that was, I cried because they were drumming and they were singing in Ojibwe, And I thought, I looked at the audience of the families, and I saw so many grandparents and parents singing along with them.
Wow.
And I just thought, like, if my grandma seen that, she would have never imagined, like, this could happen in school,
mm-hmm.
Which historically has been a place of fear and pain and
right.
neglect for a lot of Indigenous people. So bringing that within the school and that healing, that's exactly what we need as a community. If we want to help students learn and be confident and be the next generation to hopefully save this planet, then we need to open up opportunity for ceremony.
Yeah.
I've had sweats with not only family, but people in the program, Build From Within. We did a pipe ceremony together. And I think that has only strengthened our bond and our sense of, you know, belonging in this program.
Perfect word, because my next question was about belonging. One of the key findings in our Vital Signs report that the Winnipeg Foundation put out last, or 2 years ago now, I guess, in 2022, was the key finding of sense of belonging and the importance in a community for people to feel like they belong to something. And that's a perfect example of that. What is the phrase sense of belonging mean to you? How important is it for youth to have that sense of belonging before they can even think about learning? And how do you foster a sense of belonging in your classrooms?
Yeah, so belonging, I think it ties into some of the bigger systems that we live in. I heard someone say, when healthcare is a mess, education is a mess. And that's exactly what's happening right now.
Mm-hmm.
We see the effects of an overworked healthcare system in our country. And it's trickling down into how teachers can function and
right.
and do their job and teach. So I think in order for you to feel like you belong, you need to be treated as such. And this is one of the reasons that the relationship between Canada and Indigenous people has been severed for so many years.
Mm.
Because the healthcare system continues to ignore us and to neglect us.
And harm in some cases.
And it has costed lives. I witnessed my own grandma. She had a surgery and she needed to go to a hospital in Winnipeg. And they let her sit there in pain and she couldn't take it anymore and she had to go home. And I've seen the treatment of Indigenous people in hospitals. And it's just really sad and disappointing. So belonging, yeah, you need supportive systems.
It's fundamental. Yeah, how do you feel like you belong in a society or a culture when you just get ignored or not treated like a human or tossed aside, or, you know, it's really upsetting. And yeah, the pandemic has exacerbated all of the previous issues that we've had. So it's going to be an uphill climb for the next few years for sure.
So the belonging part, I think culture as well, embracing different cultures. And I think teachers today have really been focusing on that, not just for Indigenous students, but students of all backgrounds.
Mm-hmm.
We have a large population in our school specifically of Ukrainian students, and they have program and they have their culture. We have their art on the walls, and they have school on Saturdays to learn English, but they consistently speak their language, and it's awesome. You know, I think every school should allow students to showcase who they are and where they come from and their families. And that's what I love about this city, though. I really do. I love the different cultures that we see and how kind the people are when they do come together. And the celebration of different backgrounds.
The celebration of differences in general is, when we were young, when I was younger, and I think, if someone was different, it was a thing to make fun of and to fear and to, push away and other them. But now it's like, oh, where are you from? You're from somewhere cool. Like, what kind of food do you like? Like, you can learn a lot from different cultures. And I think that shift has been such an important change to how people treat each other. I mean, there's obviously still pockets of individuals that are still living in the old ways of sort of othering people. But what are you optimistic about? What are you looking forward to? What are some things that, other than, how Winnipeg is now a little bit more inclusive when it comes to cultures, but what are some things that you're excited about in the future or in the next couple of years that you see as like, this is something to be optimistic about?
I'm excited for students to continue learning about themselves and to continue fighting for their rights and advocating for themselves. Despite all of the stressors that have been put on students from K to 12 and beyond that in university, despite the pressures and the sense of impending doom a little bit with, the political climate and climate change and some of the conflicts that we're seeing around the globe and the wars. Despite all of that, there is still a very powerful resilience and just this feeling of we're going to get through this that students display. And they do that by showing up and being willing to learn about things that maybe aren't the most interesting and maybe can be really challenging sometimes, but they do it because they know that when they grow up, they're gonna make some serious changes. Mm-hmm. And I always, I just think about all the things that we learn from children. Like, I tell them all the time, like, you teach me things every day. Mm-hmm. And I'm not any smarter than you. I'm not better than you. And you just gotta keep your voice going, keep the momentum. I'm hopeful for the future because I know that there's, something's going to give, and it always does. And it's when people come together that you see change, and nothing that nothing impactful has ever come from silence. It's come from fight and voice and bodies coming together and people of different backgrounds and different experiences having one motive, which is let's save the world, like let's save the planet.
Let's improve things.
Yeah.
I'm curious your perspective on the absolute need to update the systems that govern us. Let's start with the education system. What are some ways that you think we need to either just throw out something and rebuild or adjust or strengthen the systems that are currently in place? Both in the education system and then just like society as a whole. What are your thoughts on system reform?
Oh, geez.
Small little topic.
I think first and foremost, some documents need to be updated. they're pretty old. Like I've had assignments where I'm looking at curriculum and it says last updated like 2000.
A lot's happened since then.
A lot. And like even if it was just a year, there's still so much to add. So you know, it's 2024 now. There's a lot that has changed and evolved. So one, like some documents, you know, they need to be updated. Another thing that I would like to see sort of evolve and grow from the place that it is now is how we view students in school.
What do you mean?
Like we should be viewed holistically. Mm. We are not robots.
Right.
We are not insert coin and spit out assignment. We need so much more than that. And I think that comes from the school system being modeled, you know, for capitalism,
right.
And
yeah.
to create workers.
Create workers, yeah.
I think we need to create better people and better humans if we really want to see things change. We should be focusing on community and strengthening our minds and honing in on our own gifts. I think students are expected to sort of copy and paste themselves over and over again and have these goals that align with what we think is right, what we think is productive, what we think will make the most money. And that's just not the case. We need to be looking at, okay, what is the student passionate about? What do they like? If they want to draw, you give them the tools to draw. You give them a solid art class. You give them access to supplies. If they want to do sports, then you put them with a good coach and you get some teams going. And you don't make it that they need to spend $200, you know, just to be in a football club. Like,
yeah.
And there's so much that we could do if we opened up our spaces, if we brought in some more natural sunlight, some plants, some comfortable seats,
mm-hmm.
you know, in classrooms. Like my students have a beanie bag and I'm like, damn.
Yeah.
Like I'd do a lot of learning if I could sit in, you know, something that's not a desk with gray walls and,
right.
you know, so I think open spaces and going outside to do your class once in a while is also really amazing too. I think we're seeing a lot more of some land-based teaching,
mm-hmm.
which I'm really grateful is being implemented as well.
Yeah, that's huge.
So updating how we think and where we're doing the thinking is important.
Yeah. Every time I speak with someone, I'm not going to call you a youth, but a younger person, younger human.
Please call me a youth.
Every time I speak with a youth, I walk away so, like, confident in the future because I just think the kids are all right. And, you know, just the way you speak, the way you approach problems, systems, ideas, and everyone I speak to is like, there's a reason that there's this anti-woke sentiment out there because they see how powerful it is when people awaken to how the world works and that we need to change it. And the people who created the systems that are currently governing us don't want things to change. And that's why they're putting out all these, you know, anyways, I'm getting on a side rant. But all of this to say that thank you for restoring my faith in humanity. At the end of our time together, we do a segment called Just Because, which is 7 questions about the causes that you care about and the effect that it's had on your life. You okay to go through those 7 with us?
Sure.
All right. Question 1, what is the very first cause you ever remember caring about?
The very first cause, I think growing up with a single mom, seeing her do everything on her own, I always just thought, there's got to be a different way to do this. There's got to be more supports, more resources. So I guess just more support for, you know, people who are single parents, who are living in a low-income household and community. And I think right now, a lot of people are talking about like the prices of everything
yeah.
and how expensive it is. So I think financial support, I would say, was probably the first cause that I really cared about.
I think, too, people don't realize how aware of things kids can be. Even, you know, the kids kind of get written off as like, he's only 9. They don't know what they're... But you know, when even at a very young age, you can kind of you can sense things.
Because they're absorbing everything. And even if they don't have the terminology for it, they know it in their hearts first, and
then
feel
you get
it.
The words later, and you're like, that's what that was.
Yeah, okay, yeah. You're like, I'm not crazy. I was feeling some real stuff here.
Right.
Yeah.
You just don't have the words to work it out. Yeah. Wow. So question, would you say your current cause is education? Is that a fair assessment?
Yeah.
So question 2, if money and politics and logistics were no issue at all, you could just snap your fingers and something would happen, what would you do in support of your cause of education?
Free education.
It's shocking to me when I hear the debate of people like, I had to pay for my college, so you should have to too. It's like, what?
Yeah.
What? It's the example of just pulling the ladder up behind you after you got to the top of the mountain, right? So yeah, like free education.
Yep, free education.
Why and what would that do?
We wouldn't have shortages of teachers and nurses and doctors, because the people that really have the brain and the passion and the heart, they would be in there in university and they'd be studying, and they wouldn't have to worry about debt, and they wouldn't have to sacrifice their livelihood for trying to get by and
survive.
Working 2-part jobs or working a full-time job and then also having to find a side hustle and all of these things. You know, they would be in school and they would be not stress-free, but a big stressor would be taken off of them.
Exactly.
And again, like I mentioned, the cost of, you know, if you want to get involved in sports, let's cut that down. And if I could, I would remove it completely.
Yeah.
I know that I wanted to do wrestling.
Mm.
And I went to like the tryout sort of thing. And then I looked at the cost and I said, I can never afford this. Mm-hmm. So I had to say goodbye to a lot of things. I had to sacrifice a lot of my interests because it was just too expensive. So if I could remove the financial barriers, then I would. Because I should not be judged based on, you know, if I can afford this $300, you know, wrestling club. Or if I can drop $800 on textbooks alone for, you know, a semester of university. And the integrity and the level of maturity and intelligence that I've seen demonstrated by people who could never afford university is amazing. And we have to stop with this, you know, this money-hungry attitude. It just doesn't help anybody. And it's a huge barrier. And I would just get rid of it if I really could.
I think about that all the time. All the squandered talent, all the art that could have been made, all of the songs that could have been written, all of the like scientific discoveries that could have happened if the person wasn't, you know, tied to a desk job because they had to pay their bills and they just have to get some job, you know, whatever, doing whatever because they can't pursue their passion. So like that's such a utopian idea, but like I'm 100% with you.
And beyond that, even the health that we would see.
The stress.
There would be less people on the street resorting to joining gangs and struggling with addiction because they don't know what to do with their life because there's so many things preventing them from doing what they want and what they would really succeed in.
Exactly.
Unfortunately, it ties back to money a lot.
Yeah. I'm noticing that as well in my travels. So question 3, we talked about this a little bit, but what's the biggest misunderstanding or the biggest stigma about the world of education right now?
Hmm. I would say this idea that we are just teachers.
Mm.
Oh, I cringe when I hear that. You're just a teacher. You just talk to them and you know, write on a board all day. No. I mean, I'm a social worker. I'm a nurse. I'm a therapist. I'm also a teacher.
You're a mediator.
The gymnastics that I do.
Yeah.
And I think it also comes from a lot of teachers are women, and the jobs and the labor of women has also been overlooked and undervalued and minimized to something that's, you know, just a hobby, just a craft.
Anyone can do it.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think that goes for not only teachers, but other professions and careers too.
Yeah.
So I think if we could open up our minds and our intellects a little bit and just look at how things really are in present day, then we would see, oh, you're not just writing just on a chalkboard and you're not just reading to kids. And we're not just teaching curriculum. We're also teaching them how to survive, how to live in this world, how to communicate with people, how to be self-sufficient, and yeah, it's so much. So
just a teacher.
Yeah.
Wow. Question 4, what's a recent victory? Personally or professionally, or did you get an A+ on a something recently, or what's a victory recently that you can share with us?
A recent victory.
Assignment, that's the word I was looking for. See, my brain is slow. What's just a recent dub that you've gotten that you're happy with?
Well, I just came back. This is like the first week back after winter break for me and for my students. And breaks are different for everybody, and every child will have a different experience. So I know some of my kids celebrated Christmas. Some of them did not.
Mm.
Some of them got gifts and had dinners and seen family.
And some did
and
not.
They got outside. Some of them didn't. Some of them were up taking care of their siblings.
Mm.
Some of them were trying to cook for themselves. Some were dealing with not knowing when they were going to have clean clothes or supper or breakfast, or when the noise of outside their room would stop. I mean, so many things that we just don't think about unless you're in education. Seeing my students after the break healthy and happy to be back, that was a big W.
It's huge.
Because for some of them, it's the only place that they get a smile and they get, you know, a hug, or they get a snack. So knowing that they were all there and they were together, it felt good.
It's a huge dub. I love
yeah.
it. Question 5, what's the best piece of advice that you've ever been given? Can be within the context of education, or it can just be life advice.
I think something that really helped me just in life outside of working with kids, outside of before I even went to university, was to really live my life to the fullest degree, and to not question myself or doubt myself, and to not put off the things that I'm passionate about. You know, it's kind of along the lines of be yourself, but it's also that life is short and you have to pick your battles and pick what you want to fight for. Pick what you want to be passionate about. And in a world where we can see what's happening across the world and across the globe, and we have built these parasocial relationships, it can get really tricky actually living for yourself and not living for a company or for a brand or, you know, for this
celebrity.
Yeah, for a celebrity, a chance to ever meet them one day. Like, all of these things, it can get messy, but just knowing what you believe in and pursuing it and, you know, enjoying life for what it is, with the negative and the positive and the abstract and the black and white, it's all just a part of the ride.
Yeah, good advice for anyone, for sure. Question 6, what advice would you give your 10-year-old self if you could be transported back and speak with them?
Oh, 10 years old.
So innocent, so pure.
That's 10 years ago. I would tell myself to be a kid. I think I was in a rush to grow up because I wanted to help my mom. I wanted to help my family. I wanted to have the means to do so and not feel so restricted and constrained as a child. There's nothing worse than knowing exactly what you would change, but you can't because you're 10. It's such a weird feeling. And I didn't have any siblings and I didn't have much cousins. So I was always around adults. And I just didn't really know how to be a kid. I didn't know how to play. I didn't know, like, what to talk about. And I often took on this, like, older kind of sibling role if I did play with kids, even if they were my age. Like, I always felt so beyond my years.
Like, you outgrew yourself.
Yeah. And I was told that a lot. Like, you're so mature. You're so...
I was going to say, you're wise beyond your years.
You're wise beyond your years.
It makes it for a great interview. So, I mean, I'm very grateful for it. But I understand the sort of, you know, the dissonance of not having that quintessential childhood experience either.
And hearing that now, it's a compliment. And it's way different because, you know, I'm 20 and it sounds nice. Mm-hmm. But when you're 10... there's just certain things you don't need to be taking on.
Right.
I didn't need to be so strong. I didn't need to be so independent. I needed to be a kid.
Right.
I didn't need to be aware of trauma.
Right.
And talking about intergenerational effects. But I was, and I did. I would give her a really long hug. And I would say, you're a kid and you can be a kid. And I would give her permission to play and to have fun and to not worry about what she looked like and to not worry about such adult things. Yeah.
Beautifully said. Question 7, the last question. What do you want to be remembered for? What do you hope your students remember you for after they move on?
I often think about how people may forget what you tell them, but they won't forget how you make them feel.
Mm-hmm.
I just want them to know, like, that I genuinely love them. I look at them and I just admire them and I adore them because they're amazing. They're awesome. They're funny. They're cool. They're smart. And they make all of the setbacks, the animosity, the, you know, the tough things worth it. If I'm going through like a hard time personally, I see them and it kind of just, it melts away for a while. I remember my first practicum, being in that classroom. I was grieving the loss of a childhood friend of mine, and I saw so many beautiful aspects of them. and it reminded me of her sometimes. Mm. And they would never know that, and I would never tell them that. But the healing that it did for me, I can't thank them enough for giving me a reason to keep pushing and to wake up in the morning and to get on the bus and to trudge through lots of snow and and to remember why I'm doing what I'm doing. So I would want them to remember me for just loving them and really caring for them.
Beautifully said. Well, let's end on love, you know? What better point to end on? Malaika Siemens, thank you so much for your time, for your wisdom, for your thoughtful answers, for the conversation, for being a part of Vital Signs a couple years ago. Your story really helped to help that publication and that whole process put a face to the stats, and you have an incredible story, and I'm just very grateful for your time. So thank you so much for being on the show.
Chimigwich for having me. Thank you.